Welcome back from that short break. We are still continuing our conversation with Pastor Dorcas Rigathi, the spouse to the Deputy President of Kenya.
I had found a way of a better way to get my mission accomplished. And so we left the person who was writing and taking the names was now His Excellency the Deputy President. He was the chair of the DUSA, or the Nyeri District Union, Students Union. And so I looked at him, he was wearing a brown a brown suit and with a checked brown tie. And I thought he was interesting, but that was not of one of my favorite subjects about men and all that. I actually had never thought I wanted to get married. I wanted to get through with my education and take care of my mom. And so I got into the bus and we went to Cabernet Gardens, and the rest was history, because when we went there, I waited for the president to stand and I was to accomplish my mission. So I went straight for him running, and I wanted them to shoot me. You can tell I didn't die, because the moment I ran towards him, I guess he must have seen, and he walked in line in with me because I went and knocked him. I was asking myself, is this how heaven feels like? Because it was a real commotion, I can tell you for free. It was bad for me because I didn't die, and here I am, and I can see all the security people heading towards me. But he actually rescued me. He went, he asked me what the issue was, and for 2 weeks he kept sending a vehicle, his escort, to come, and he would talk to me. And I can tell you the counsel that he gave me is the one that has brought me this far. He told me there was no need of committing suicide because of an incident, and I will find crisis in life. And many people, what you need, he said, tough people outlive the tough times. And what one needs is to pray. And that was it. And from there, I really could see life in a different perspective. I was at the university. What he did, at least he was able to pay for the medical, for those ones who had been, who got hurt. And he made sure that my mom was paid for the rents, because wherever she was now had come down. So he helped in that way. But mostly what he did is that counsel. In fact, what I remember most and treasure is the way he spoke to me. He gave me back my life, and you know, and the hope. And I realized that I was valuable and I was important at that time. I had thought it was over and I didn't want to leave. But I must say, I got a father who spoke into my life. So fathers are very important. It appears like His Excellency also had an issue that he wanted to see the president about. So the following day, when I was called to come and see the president, I found him there with the family. And he was just pointing at me, and he was telling the mother, that is the girl I was telling you about. And I think that my mother-in-law said, just go for her. And because I had it, I made sure I made it very difficult for him to meet me. But he did persist, and here we are 35 years later.
You have been married for over 3 decades. 35 years to be precise. Today, most young people are struggling to keep their marriages going after a month, a few weeks, or even a year. Most times people go their separate ways. How have you managed to keep your marriage going for this long?
You know, wedding is an event, but marriage is a process. Many people want the white wedding, they want what it goes, what girls will talk about, the great gown that you are wearing, but that is not marriage. Marriage is a process and it is hard work. You must work for your marriage, you must fight for it. And I know over those very many years, there are times we would disagree over small things sometimes. Like when I was in the university, he was in the university, we got married immediately after, and we were living in that one small room. And when I got my first baby, he had been sent to another, he became a district officer, he was sent to another town, I was in another town, and we had to work very hard to make it work, because you are young, you are pregnant, and somebody is in another town, and you are in another town, and God sometimes works in a mysterious way. So I'm taken near him, in a, where he could come, like evening, it is like 1 hour away, and then when I've just landed, he's taken back to Nairobi. And later we were to be brought back to Nairobi, and we worked in other fields to make ends meet. And that is what marriage is about. Many of the marriages that, because I'm a pastor, I think what people think is that you just read the books, you know, happily ever after. Nobody wants to work to be able to make it happen. Everyone wants the other one to love you and to do all the lovey-doveys, and they do not want to get serious. A woman wants to be bought everything, and she wants a big home, she wants a car, and she also wants the husband to be with her. Those two do not work. There are sacrifices that you are going to find, because as you leave now the girl and boy relationships, you come to a mature relationship where now you are the mother and he's the father, and he has to work. And as he's working, you also have to take care of the children. Sometimes the children would get sick and he's not there. I have to work, and sometimes at night, you know. And what I love about my husband is that even though he was away, he will find and steal time from his work in the night, and he will arrive very late just to come and see us, just to come and see his children. And it was very amazing for me. In fact, why I fell in love with him, I saw him treat his mother, and the way he worked very hard at the university. He had actually a car which he bought by whatever he was doing within the university. And that hard work and the love he had for his mother, those are the two things that I thought were good picks for me. And sure, even up to now, those things, those two qualities have remained.
I was actually going to ask you what kind of husband he has been to you for the 35 years. Because when we look out there, some comments are not very kind to him. When you see the media and all that, people are not too kind to the deputy president at times. So I just wanted to know the kind of husband he has been, and if people are actually wrong to carry those kind of thoughts towards him.
One thing I say is that media has its own right and its own opinion. And I think they have been most unfair to my husband. Mostly, perhaps, it's because media was in bed with the opposition. And obviously, when you are in opposition with someone, it is you hammer things which will make him look bad. But I can tell you for free, they did say that and even talk like he had never gone to school. It is only when they went for the debate that they had that people started to acknowledge that this is an educated man, and this man had gone to school, and he has a brain, and you know, they were making fun, and they have continued to do that. They would make fun about his clothing. They would just, even if you want to look, sometimes when you look at the photo of my whatever and you want to emphasize on that, you can. But he's a very well dressed man. I dress him in the morning, and I make sure his suit is okay. His tie is fine. And I think he has freedom to wear what he wants. He has also the freedom to speak as a free man, to speak the truth. What you find with him may be what many people are not used to, is a straight talker and somebody who is truthful and will not mince his word. So perhaps that is something that the world is not used to. And they had just better get used to him. He's a straight talker. He shoots from the hip. If he thinks something is not good, it is not good. If it is good, it is good. And when you come to the family, he's a kind man. He's loving to his children. He's loving to his wife. If you look at me, do you see any scratches on me? At 58, yes. You can tell that he has been taking good care of me. And so I can tell you he's a wonderful father. I don't remember one time I called him and he didn't pick the phone, or the children called him and he didn't pick. If he doesn't, it's because he's in a place he can't, and immediately he'll call to check on us. And it's been that way for the many years. When it comes also to a covering and being a husband, he's very protective, and also he allows me to be and to follow my vision. He has supported the ministry I do. He also has supported me in my dreams. He does not bother, like when I have been in Bahrain now for many days. He just goes to check me out.
Well, Pastor, it has been such a pleasure talking to you. We have gotten to know so much about how your journey started. It wasn't an easy one, but it was a beautiful ending for you. And today, here you are in the position of a second lady, or, you know, spouse of the deputy president of the Republic of Kenya. And you're also a pastor preaching the word of God and changing many lives, not just in Kenya, but across the East African bloc and beyond. It was a pleasure. We hope to speak to you yet again sometime when our path cross. For now, goodbye. I have been your host, Jackie Achan. Until next time.